Good evening, friends. We are here to celebrate one wonderful life that we had with Ashok Patsarthi. Those of us who have been working on issues related to science policy and the larger national development goals know it very well how Ashok Patsarthi was dedicated for that. Unfortunately, we lost him on 12th of August. Professor Ashok Patsarthi was a physicist and electronics engineer, as we know, and was dedicated in the science policy and its analysis. He taught physics at Birla Institute of Technology and Science in Palani, and was at MIT for pursuing his studies in technology policy. He joined the Department of Atomic Energy in 1967, Atomic Energy Commission with Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, and then led the Ministry of Electronics. He worked with Mrs. Gandhi very closely, right from 1970 to 76, and then 1980 to 84. And during that process, he contributed immensely, initially as Joint Secretary and then as Secretary in Department of Electronics. He was also very closely associated with DSIR, Ministry of Non-Conventional Energy Sources, and Department of Small Scale Industries. Professor Patsarthi's decade-long tenure in Department of Electronics also saw sort of great push for creating some 14 professional electronics companies that provided the nation the very much required support in microchips semiconductor complex, which later came up near Chandigarh. Incidentally, with RIS, he was very closely involved, though RIS was largely sort of led by his father, G. Patsarthi. But it was Ashok Patsarthi who was very closely involved with us in encouraging RIS work program on connecting economy with science, technology, and innovation. And it was that sort of field which got me close to Ashok Patsarthi right in 1992. And since then, we have been working together, discussing issues, and Ashok Patsarthi could bring in the heft, the bandwidth which is required to analyze an economy which is opening. And at that point, the liberalization process had just started. And Ashok Patsarthi was very keen that RIS should focus on issues that are related to opening up and joint venture participation with other firms. And the approvals which were being granted to these joint venture linkages, Ashok Patsarthi was very keen that we should analyze the technology component of it. And that's how we worked very closely with him. I was myself given the task as a researcher to look into the contents of frontier technologies, on which my vice chairman, Shukma Chakravarti, was also very keen that we find out the interlinkages at the sectoral level on how FDI policy is bringing in the heft which is required in India's foreign sector linkages. So Dr. Nagesh Kumar, Dr. Biswajit Dhar, they were spearheading this program, and Ashok Patsarthi was very closely linked in a very informal manner. But as all of you know, there was nothing informal or formal with him. He was always so assertive and so persuasive that everybody would listen to him. And this is how he remained with all of us in RIS faculty. The other dimension of Professor Ashok Patsarthi that was very closely linked with our work program was his idea of South-South cooperation, or cooperation among the developing countries. During his lifetime, he was very closely associated with UNIDO, with UNCTAD, with UNEP, and with WIPO. These are abbreviations for those of you who are not aware, for largely the UN bodies where trade, investment, and technology-related work programs are being led by these bodies. He was also associated with South Center in Geneva, which is a sort of organization spearheading global cooperation among the southern countries, among the developing countries. He was also associated with the PUGWASH, and that's where the whole issue of self-reliance, which he was articulating right from 67 onwards, came to the fore, and he was associated with the dimensions of engagement which are important from the perspective of developing countries. The non-aligned movement which Mrs. Gandhi was leading, the economic perspective of it through technology was something that Ashok Panchsatih was closely engaged in. We have Professor Muchkund Dubey here, who was another dimension bringing in on the table in terms of our engagement at the global platforms when we were talking about self-reliance. And it was not just for articulation's sake that Ashok Panchsatih was doing that. Those of us who have followed his work are fully aware of his contribution in SCL in Chandigarh, the time at which it came up and the reasons that delayed the whole plant and the loss that country had to bear because of that delay. So what we requested towards the end of his life was to bring out his knowledge connected with the science diplomacy. The current ministry has huge focus in terms of what are the lessons we can learn from India's science diplomacy experience. And this we requested a couple of scientists and policymakers to write out. And during last few days, he was busy writing that. And fortunately, by the time he was struggling with the several challenges at the level of his health, he finished writing that. And the paper is there. My colleagues would bring that out. Some copies we have got here for circulation. It brings out the experience on SCL and how the partnership with several departments is so very important for the developing countries to bring in coherence and action that is required by the governments to follow. So where diplomacy could have pitched in, what they could have actually delivered, and why in semiconductors? Because as all of us now know, that our oil import bill now is lesser than our bill for electronics. And this is what Ashok was trying to do in terms of bringing in that policy regime that was required. And it was way back in 1978 that semiconductor policy came in. He was pushing in. The government, as we know, in between we lost out, and 1980 when Mrs. Gandhi came back, this was one of the PAT projects that was being pushed, and by 1982 it became operational. We circulated this idea to Ministry Department of Science and Technology. They agreed. We requested Ashok, and this paper is out. We have similarly approached another sort of eight key policymakers who have held various portfolios in Ministry of Science and Technology to write out such case studies, because this documentation, as Ashok would always say, was very important for us to learn policy lessons. And this paper is his sort of last output, but I would say that is important in terms of even understanding the books that he did, whether he did for Pugwash on self-reliance and scientific cooperation for development, or the one that he did for Mrs. Indira Gandhi. The title was Technology at the Core, Science and Technology with Indira Gandhi. So those two books and several papers that he did, they bring out the essential core commitment that he had in terms of seeing India where India should be. So we thought it would be good to have some people who have worked closely with him this evening to recall the great contribution he made. I would request Sri Voraji, President of India International Center, with which RIS approached to partner, and I'm extremely thankful to him for agreeing to partner for this evening. I would request him to chair the rest of the evening and lead us through. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Chairman, and thank you all. I'm a little intimidated, I think, by the distinguished nature of this audience. And there's, of course, one can spend the entire evening, but I'm not going to do that. Closer? Is it okay now?
Volume, Sachin, we can...
Is that all right now?
There's a volume.
I didn't think that was necessary for me ever, but never mind. The first time it's happening. I think it would be only proper to indicate a bias in what I'm going to say right away. And the bias comes from a family connection that we had between the Parsarthis, as it were, and my grandmother. They were classmates in Madras, GP, that is. And when he married Sabar, there was massive hangama in the conservative Mylapore in Madras. And everybody wanted to know why GP did what he did. And that actually, that episode more or less lasted right up until quite a long time. Until, I would say, Ashok married Vibha. And then it stopped. This meeting, rightly, is about Ashok Parsarthi. It's not about Indian science and technology. But in fact, were it to be so, the two would almost be congruent for a very great part of the discourse that might be held. And the reasons for those are many. There's a book called A Lifetime of Molding Technology and Science Policy in India. Well, allow me to go back a little more. GP was in London. My father had been posted there. He was also of the Hindu. And when he came there at the last year when I was spending the last few months with the Science Policy Research Unit in Sussex, Ashok had told him that one of the people who ought to be there for the Center for the Study of Science Policy, which he was instrumental in getting into the JNU lexicon, if you like, rather obviously, would be me, and therefore would he please make sure that I come back when he went to London, which he did. I mean, his father, GP, did. But when I came back, and I don't know how he answered the audit, because he was then the vice chancellor of JNU, and he paid for my trip back. But after I came back here, he calls me and says, see AP, Ashok first and then come and see me. So I went and saw Ashok. And then he said, you better go in after that. And then he gave me Ashok said, you know, we have this thing called the NCST and we need a secretariat and so on and so forth. I won't go into that in detail, although it is connected. And it was Ashok who then sort of essentially press ganged his father to let me go and become part of the NCST. So in that process, of course, his father and Ashok in particular told C. Subramaniam that I ought to be on the right side of the fence, quote unquote. And so that's how the Center for Study for Science Policy was saved from me. So this book has this title because he asked me that there was going to be this fresh shift, and Ashok asked me what kind of a title should it have. So this title is actually something that I had an opportunity to mention to him on the telephone, and that's how it came to be. Something else. The foreword to this has been signed by Munkumbu Sambasivan Swaminathan. Now, Munkumbu was short for M.S. Swaminathan to many of us, the two Ashoks in particular, Parsarthi and Khosla, who unfortunately is not here today. They didn't get on very well, by the way. And so this fresh shift, which is tells the story essentially of his involvement of Indian science and technology for the decade and decade and a half, more or less, that he was intimately involved with it. There are two separate stories here, some of which have yet to be told. And this face shift is really for Ashok Parasarathy, but it's also in many ways about him. The volume is contributions from members of the scientific and engineering communities whose own significant contributions to the nation's self-reliance in S&T, and it was not the same as the self-reliance in economics. And there was this constant fight between the two in the two dhars, PN Dhar and DP Dhar, and of course the NCST and C. Subramaniam. That's another story that it's actually continuing. It's become worse. And particularly during the prime ministership of the two prime ministerships of Indira Gandhi. And all of that have been enabled in no small measure by Ashok through a role that he played as a facilitator intervener. That is the best way I think he would describe him. He was a facilitator intervener in the business of policy articulation and implementation. He would say this semicolon is in the wrong place, that kind of detail. And he played a facilitator intervener against an often ununderstanding, if not hostile, officialdom. And I would say that this Festschrift is an overdue tribute and should be read by all young people, because although he came from a rather industrious family, he didn't use his positions of influence for his personal benefit or aggrandizement. He used those positions for what he thought was the benefit of the country, not necessarily the same as what others thought similarly, but he was without doubt entirely wedded to the cause and to which he remained committed, namely while he was in office and even when he was out of it, and that of advancing Indian self-reliance in science and technology. And that came into conflict very often with self-reliance in economics because of the contradictions that were involved in import substitution. This is something that Jairam knows a great deal more about than I do, and I dare say he will say something about that. One or two last points. By the way, this other book, Technology at the Core, is also essential reading, but there are mistakes in it. There are mistakes of fact, and these need correction. There are not many mistakes, in fact I would say none, of interpretation except one, but I won't mention it here. And the reason why I'm saying this is that I've known him long enough to be able to say this without offense to his family or to anybody else, because it's extremely important that the facts that emerged after Bangladesh and the drive towards self-reliance in science and technology without which this country could not ever get to the position that it is in today. And what is that position? Of all the post-independent, post-colonial countries, without exception, and possibly with the exception of China, but that's a post-revolutionary country, an advantage we have not had, at least not yet. And if you look at that, you will find that the Indian science and technology infrastructure and its capabilities are without doubt the best of all the post-colonial countries of the world. This is not adequately recognized. It's not adequately used in the manner in which it should be, largely because, in my view, the economic community is completely bereft of any understanding of what science and technology can do, except as some kind of an input which is provided subsequent to all decisions that have been taken in economics. Don't want to go on about that at this gathering, but let it be said that finally, that individuals are important, and what they do and do not do are also important. His relationships with the top rung of the scientific community, as he pointed out, that they were not accidental, that various people had been placed by Indira Gandhi in various positions, starting with him, Ramanna, Dhawan, Nag Chaudhary, and of course, in a different kind of field, but nevertheless extremely important, Petroleum, our friend. Petroleum. No. Lavraj Kumar. Okay, very, very important in that, because that ONGC connection was extremely, extremely important. And in that, Anil Malhotra. And so if you look at the signatories to the National Committee on Science and Technology approach paper, you will find all these names there, including Anil's. That came to naught because of a, can only be described in Hindi, I think it's the best way to, a sadish. And that sadish was hatched. Satish.
Sajish.
Yes. Sajish. What did I say?
Conspiracy.
Yes. Conspiracy. Somehow, even if it's wrong, it comes out better. Of the two Dhars who ensured that the NCST approach paper got buried. Because it spoke, among other reasons, of a technology policy statement. A technology policy resolution of the government of India, a la the scientific policy resolution, which came out in 1958. By the way, it is scientific policy resolution, not science policy resolution. Important distinction. Buried in that document, without understanding, is the fact that what was asked for was that our policies should be scientific in their inner content. It was not about, in essentially, policies for science. You may need policies for science, but they're not essential if you want scientific policy. When it came to this, it finally ended up with a technology policy statement again in 1982. And that was at a time when Mrs. Gandhi said this was the final culmination of two things, essentially the scientific policy resolution, the NCST approach paper, and the technology policy statement. Unfortunately, Mrs. Gandhi got sidetracked by that time. With an insurgency in the Punjab, which finally killed her, and therefore no attempt was made to implement the technology policy statement, which more or less died with her. In all this process, Ashok was central. And he came home one day after the TPS was announced with Baldev Singh, then at CSIR, his wife, and he's right here. He came and both of them said, "Your package, it's through." So I said, "Yes, except that if the NCST was 10 years too early, the technology policy statement was 10 years too late." We will need all the documentation to be able to get some perspective, particularly the younger people in this country who seem to think that everything that they see around them arose just like that. I mean, it emerged. It's a word that's widely used, and that no great effort was involved. At least four of the members of the present Planning Commission, and even the previous one, have never visited an Indian laboratory. And they make plans for Indian science and technology. I won't dwell on this, because this is exactly the kind of thing that Ashok was against. It cost him his job in many ways, because at one stage there were all sorts of allegations, CBI inquiries, this, that, and the other. I don't want to get into all that. But even when, and I have mentioned this in my contribution to this volume, when he was in a place like shunted out effectively to the SCST Council Department and Council Commission, the first thing he did was to call me and said, "What can we do with science and technology for the SC and ST community?" I said, "I haven't the faintest idea what can be done about this thing. What am I supposed to do?" "See, you better study all this and come back to me." I said, "What is this? What is this firman you're giving me?" So he said, "Come on, yaar." So that was how I had then got into another line entirely about rural development and the use of the biological sciences, particularly for those parts of the communities which depended very much on land and its produce. That's all I really want to say for the present moment of time. I greatly value this opportunity to pay my respects in many ways, but also a bit of annoyance at Ashok. He had no business to go at the time that he did. I thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Siddharth. I now call upon Dr. Shiv Vishwanathan.
I must confess my narrative is going to be very different. I never knew Ashok Parjati officially. We fought for 3 decades, and I'll tell you why we fought. In fact, the first time I met him, he referred to my friend Ashish Nandi and said, that scientific temper document is an absolutely illiterate one. And I told him, that's precisely the trouble with your group at the Science Academy and the Electronics Commission. You people pretend to be literate when you have no idea of the history of science. And we fought. And what is wonderful is we enjoyed the fight. And I think for the first time I realized he was a guy who enjoyed a fight. In fact, he was not polite. Ashok was one guy who called a spade a shovel and did so with great delight. And it was also quite interesting that later, ironically, he became one of my PhD evaluators. That interview was also one big fight. But at the end of it, he offered me my first job in the Electronics Commission, wickedly adding that maybe the Electronics Commission can tame characters like you. Of course, I didn't take the job. But I think what was remarkable about the guy was the way he enjoyed quarreling about science as a part of the celebration of science. And he could be very even-tempered about it. I remember we continued quarreling almost about everything. I remember once we had a huge fight about the emergency and Rajni Kothari. But what was interesting was he could transcend it with anecdotes, with stories, with histories, which made him a very different kind of person. I think Ashok Parjati sounds too official in this audience. And I think there's an informal, easygoing Ashok Parjati who had a tremendous sense of humor and a tremendous sense of fun, not just about science, but about life. And I got to know this different Ashok through a common friend, C.V. Seshadri. I remember when Ashok was in NRDC, Ashok had a tremendous sense of dissenting, marginal, alternative imaginations. And when Seshadri's work on spirulina had to be commercialized, it could not have been done without Ashok. I mean, that's something that Seshadri acknowledged. But what was beautiful was that when the patent system for the algae was seen, everyone from the cook to the driver to the guard in the laboratory had a part in the patent. And both celebrated this idea of science as a commons. I think these parts of Ashok somehow get missing. And in fact, Seshadri himself once said, every time we write a scientific autobiography, we make it sound like a recommendation certificate. People like Ashok, I think, went beyond that. And I think it's in this context that we've got to understand that here was a man who understood the critique of science. It was not something that he faced easily, but I think eventually he understood the idea of an alternative science, an alternative imagination, and also the possibility of a different kind of scientific internationalism. Ashok's contributions to Pugwash have to be understood in this context. Last week I was in Bangalore at the Raman Institute, and someone said, how do you describe a patriot? And he said, anyone who calls a spade a shovel. And I think in this era of scientific silence which haunts us today, Ashok was a patriot for science, which made him a very cosmopolitan international figure. And in this context, we got to understand that Ashok was self-reflective. He was not only one of the heroes of the import substitution era, I think he was one of its finest sociologists. Ashok, the academic, is ignored. Ashok, the policymaker, is emphasized. And I hope somewhere in your fresh rift, you'll create a complementarity between the academic and the policymaker. He was fun to be with. And I think in the gravitas of science policy, sometimes the man is lost. I'd like to pay a small tribute to the man, who was also a science policymaker, a scientist, but most of all, great fun to be with, especially if you wanted someone to disagree with. Thank you.
she like to come? Doctor, roll, please.
I came to know Ashok because I got into science policy studies, the center which probably Siddharth would have been there right from the day it was set up. And we were the first guinea pigs of science technology policy studies. There were hardly any at that time teachers. People who were mentoring science policy studies were physicists, they were not even social scientists, or there were two physicists and one was a philosopher, and there was no economist. And the philosopher was having a viewpoint that much of the science and technology that was being guided at the atomic energy and space is a misplaced priority. So the learning when was taking place, Ashok was one of the few people whom one had to read and I think learned what is Indian science technology all about. If you read Ashok, and I read him as an educator, just now the point was made that Ashok has been appreciated more as a policymaker, but I didn't have that vantage point. I could have never appreciated him as just a policy maker, but I came to know him as a person, whom I had to read, learn from. And if you read some of his early writings as far as he's concerned, the point that was made that his commitment to self-reliance, he was unwavering in that. And if you look at his concept of self-reliance, and just now Shiv mentioned about we have to understand his sociology or the social aspect of science and technology. And I just have his paper with me here, if anybody wants to look at that alternative paper, his 1976 paper. He says, what can S&T do? Siddharth said, he articulated that. He says, S&T, the science and technology, can prevent you from becoming just imitative of the West. It can teach you what are the choices before us. And he wrote about that we will not get trapped into technological fixing if we really have our own indigenous science and technology effort. Whether it is studying about renewable and non-renewable later, which he also engaged with, both as a policymaker, as a secretary in the MNRE and other places, if you look at. And the kind of development that of his thought, as I see, is one of the very few people who was consistent right through in his science and technology philosophy approach. And he actually articulates that the tools and methods by which self-reliance actually should be assessed. And if you read that, what would be the essential components of a self-reliant strategy? He says, generate and put to use those elements of scientific investigation and technological know-how which would allow autonomous decision-making processes. And not autonomous, even saying absorbing foreign technology, not only while developing domestic content of the technology. So a person who had an understanding of why S&T capacity is needed. And Siddharth rightly mentioned about that in India, the kind of domination which the economic self-reliance concept had, and that placed a lot of contradictions, and subsequently 80s and 90s. If you look at that history, we virtually said everything can be imported. And in fact, the Prime Minister of this country had stated so in this. Today, of course, it has been taken to the extreme ends of saying, who will make in India? Some of the people come from abroad and make in India. He never believed in that. He believed in that setting up Indian institutions, public sector, the role of number of companies which he set up in the area of electronics, which played a role in number of sectors, including renewable energy, solar, and program, which are today now getting the right amount of priority. The challenge that Ashok recognized in the area of when I see his consistency in the papers and I read the 76 paper and 67 paper, if you look at what really made him write in science policy studies in a consistent way, I think comes from the fact that he did not actually imitate anybody, whether Sproul. You know, I grew up in the environment where Baldev and Rahman and others believed that we have to set up an alternate Sproul, alternative to Science Policy Research Unit of University of Sussex. These were people who actually managed to actually keep that whole alternate thinking in S&T alive as well. And I think Ashok was the pillar of that. When in 2000, if you look at his writings, when he's writing on the electronics itself, because by then the electronics had got geared to the ITC services, information technology and communication services, largely supporting the Western markets, the foreign markets. He's talking of why electronics should be now reoriented towards the domestic market. He's articulating in his paper, saying clearly, actually, what we need to do. Again, I see what kind of applications electronics can be put to. In fact, he has a concept of what is called societal applications of electronics itself. He's arguing that what kind of areas to which electronics needs to be committed. These were people who were pioneered, whether it's the railway reservation, computerization of that, and very many other areas which he identifies and says now new areas are identifiable. That's what electronics should be geared towards. So the commitment to self-reliance, commitment to saying there are options available, we don't need to get trapped into technological fixing, S&T capacity is needed in order to make actually India different from the rest of the world, the pathways which it can take. He articulated them in several of his papers. In fact, if you read the post-2000 papers, you can find them in Economic and Political Weekly, you can find them in Current Science. If you read all these papers together, actually there's a need for an appreciation, saying how that person who's been suggested as, how ill-tempered he was. In fact, I think he was one of the, I'm talking of not ill-tempered in terms of abrasion, but the person who did not see the alternate pathways. I think his writings actually show a huge amount of scientific temper. In his writings, there is a clear articulation of saying India need not copy anybody. And it will not be able, it will be able to only become creative, it will be different from the rest of the world if it cultivates science and technology and not Rahu and Ketu. So in fact, the very understanding why indigenous science capacity is needed is he appreciated, right? From his paper came in 1969, the first one, that the appearance and reality in science and science policy. And if you read till the last paper, which he writes, as far as I know of, is on this diplomacy. That what is the role of a diplomat? You see a connection between all his papers, and I would really love to write a paper on appreciating the connection between various papers that, and there is one, right, as I said, unwavering commitment to the concept of self-reliance, the concept of Indian nation, how Indian nation can be different. His idea of India is not to imitate West. Ashish other day, Nandi, was saying that, Indian future is now going to be what the future of what the West already has had. But here was a man who was articulating in the S&T capacity a different idea of India is possible. And he showed it in whether S&T for rural development, whether it's self for spirulina commercialization to, support to C.V. Sushadri. Another one was the invert sugar, which is a BARC technology, which he tried transferring as far as it's concerned, which Pepsi-Cola absorbed. So if you look at number of examples where he played a role, and I remember when he was shunted to the SCST, and he called us, he says, what can we do? So we discussed number of possibilities which are there. And I would say that not only it's a loss that will be not easy to fill, and I think Ashok needs to be appreciated, and through bringing his writings together, and let the younger generation, and even I would say the older generation, let me say that I do not think that we understand what Ashok was all about. From 69 to when I started reading him, you said 58 was 10 years early as far as his concern. And I think, but he was concerned about why the scientific policy resolution could not achieve what it should have achieved as far as he's concerned. And he was trying to, and I think Siddharth Mother made other day a very important point, the way he used to actually insulate S&T priorities, and because S&T is one investment which requires a long gestation period. And if long gestation period, you have to isolate, you have to create niches, you have to be protective about it. And he knew how to protect science and technology. And I think he protected it till the last day. And I think, and I'm one feels his absence altogether. We found him always blunt, clear, sharp, and never found him abrasive. He was a friend, and we became friends even while we were very younger. Younger to him, certainly he's 79. I am at least 13 years younger than him. So we enjoyed always his company. He was a great friend, and we knew him as a person who taught us all the time. Thank you very much.
Dr. Jairam.
Mr. Vora, members of the Ashok Parsathi family and friends. I've been for many years a friend, an admirer, and a critic of Ashok Parsathi, and I will make my comments on each of these three dimensions. The first thing that struck me about Ashok and continues to strike me about Ashok is the extraordinary family that he comes from. We all know that G.P. was his father, and we all know the contributions that G.P. Parsathi made in the world of diplomacy, the big Parsathi Accord, peace in Mizoram. Less known, of course, is the fact that he is a leg spin googly bowler who was adept at cricket, played Ranji Trophy in cricket, was a blue in tennis and hockey, and a multidimensional personality. But what is often not recognized is Ashok's mother, who was an extraordinary character in her own right. Subur Mugaset, who comes from this absolutely romantic family of Mugasets of Calicut, which incidentally has been described brilliantly by Girish Karnad's son, Raghu Karnad, in a book on the Mugasets recently. And Mrs. Parsathi was a formidable figure in her own right, played a very important role in the shaping of Ashok, and became a member of parliament in 1960. And I was recently looking at one of the recently released selected works of Jawaharlal Nehru. And on the 15th of March, 1960, Nehru gives a 3-hour press conference in Vigyan Bhavan. Those were the days when prime ministers gave press conferences where questions were asked, impromptu questions were asked. And Nehru is asked by a journalist, question, would you like to clarify the position regarding the nomination of Mrs. Parthasarathy as a candidate to the Rajya Sabha, because an allegation has been made in a Madras paper that being a government servant, the lady cannot be a member of the legislature. So government servants have to be invalidated. There is confusion in this. Prime Minister, well, when I came back from Dholpur rather late at night, I saw a paper drawing my attention to this, and I think this piece of news probably occurred in a South Indian weekly. Question, the questioner, Swarajya. Yes, yes, it's a piece with the Swatantra Party sayings of Rajaji. Why my name was dragged in, I do not know. I have never heard of this till very recently. I did not know that Mrs. Parthasarathy was likely to be nominated. I heard that the Madras Congress Committee had recommended her name. That is all I know. I don't understand what this controversy is all about. Another correspondent, she has resigned as a government servant. Prime Minister, yes, she has to choose between government servant and membership of the Rajya Sabha. It seems to me nothing wrong about a person choosing this. That is a straightforward thing. And here is the clincher. Another journalist. In the party given by the Congress Party of the legislature to the ex-president of the Congress, Mrs. Parthasarathy has expressed the hope that younger elements should be given chances at all levels. And in the government today, there are many who are old, unfortunately with heart attacks and so on. Why are they being overburdened with work? Why not take younger elements now? Prime Minister, this is a matter for my consideration in the future. Well, Mrs. Parthasarathy then became, of course, a very distinguished member of the Rajya Sabha, died very young in 1966. So this family that Ashok comes from, the mother, the father, and of course his grandfather, who can forget, who is in the headlines today, the author of Article 370, and a man who was roundly condemned in Parliament in the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha a couple of weeks ago. But an extraordinary man in his own right, N. Gopal Swami Iyengar, who Nehru depended on for many, many things. And as I discovered very recently, the man who discovered the formula for India remaining in the Commonwealth. There was a big controversy. Nehru was against India remaining in the Commonwealth because we had to recognize the place of the king. And no formula could be found which could satisfy the British, the Canadians, the Australians, the South Africans, and everybody else, till Nehru consulted Gopal Swami Iyengar. And Gopal Swami Iyengar, in a masterpiece of English, which he must have consulted his daughter-in-law by then perhaps, comes up with the formulation, the king as an association, the king as a symbol of the free association of new nations. And that's what it finds its place in the Commonwealth Statute, and India became a member of the Commonwealth. So the first thing about Ashok is the family. Second, at the age of 30, Ashok becomes the first and last special assistant to the Prime Minister for Science and Technology. That is his exact designation. He's not advisor, he's not deputy secretary, he's not director or joint secretary. He's called special assistant to the Prime Minister for Science and Technology. And for 1970 till 1976, he functions as a special assistant. And this, of course, is entirely because of P.N. Haksa. It is P.N. Haksa who takes a 30-year-old Ashok Parthasarathy into the Prime Minister's secretariat and gives him the protection that he requires. In fact, Ashok's effectiveness vanishes really after January of 1973, when Mr. Haksa leaves the Prime Minister's secretariat. But as long as Mr. Haksa is there, Ashok and Mr. Haksa function as a duo to create the foundations of modern Indian science and technology. Institutions, but more importantly, people. The most inspired appointment that Mr. Haksa and Ashok make is the selection of Satish Dhawan in January of 1972 to replace Vikram Sarabhai. Incidentally, what I have never been able to understand is that Ashok was a protege of Vikram Sarabhai from 67 to 71, but spent all his time till 70, but spent all his time then criticizing Vikram Sarabhai, so much so that Vikram Sarabhai is writing to Mr. Haksa saying, can you please keep Ashok quiet? Can you please not have Ashok attend meetings of the Atomic Energy Commission? It seems Ashok by then had become convinced that atomic energy is not the route that India should be taking, and that we are actually over-investing in nuclear energy and making promises, extravagant claims, which will never be fulfilled. That is from a civilian nuclear power point of view, not necessarily from a weapons and strategic point of view. The appointment of Dr. Swaminathan. There is a wonderful story of the appointment of Dr. Swaminathan. Swaminathan is appointed as DG of ICAR to succeed Dr. B.B. Pal. And Mr. Haksa tells Ashok Parthasarathy, tell Mangambu not to take over till I tell him to take over. And for 3 months, Swaminathan is sitting, cooling his heels. He doesn't know why he's not being asked to take over. And then suddenly Ashok calls him and says, Swami, you can now take over. Haksa has said you can take over. And then Mr. Swaminathan, Dr. Swaminathan, discovers why this delay had taken place. His original appointment was, the president is pleased to appoint Dr. Swaminathan as DG ICAR and ex officio additional secretary in the Ministry of Agriculture. And the new office order read, the president is pleased to appoint Dr. Swaminathan as DG ICAR and ex officio secretary of the Department of Agricultural Research and Education. That was the first time, sir, you will remember, that was the beginning of the revamping and reconfiguring of ICAR, in which actually Ashok played a very, very important role. So for those 3 years, he functioned as the writer for many of Mr. Huxley's notes, the formation of the Electronics Commission, the reconstitution of the CSIR, and the appointment of B.D. Nag Chaudhary as scientific advisor in the Ministry of Defense, which was a clear indication that India was had decided to go nuclear way back in 1970 itself. So this was a fascinating chapter in Ashok's life, and much of it is contained in his book, Technology at the Core, which was published in 2007. But I agree with Siddharth that there are many things that need to be corrected there, particularly in view of the fact that the Huxar archives are now open, and you can cross-check many of the things that are mentioned here. But the fact remains that Ashok did play a very crucial role in the Prime Minister's Secretariat on decisions and matters relating to science and technology, largely because of the protection and encouragement that he received from Mr. Huxar. Then, of course, there is this 10-year period in which Ashok, with M.G.K. Menon, takes over the stewardship of the electronics industry. And I would argue that both Professor Menon and Ashok were extraordinarily successful in building India's capability in defense electronics, in professional electronics, but I'm afraid they were responsible for India missing the bus in consumer electronics. This we can argue. This is a controversial topic. Mr. Sarabi is here. He will have his own view. This is a view that Ashok and I have always argued. And this is a view, by the way, that's not new. This was articulated way back in 1980 itself by the Mantosh Sondhi Committee, which looked at India's electronic scene. And the basic point that was being made was India did not become part of the global supply chain in the electronics hardware industry, but focused largely on building self-reliance in defense and professional electronics, of which, of course, we have had great benefits. But one of the consequences of that was the scale of operation in consumer electronics was suboptimal. We do not have, none of the Trons have succeeded. Uptron, Keltron, Meltron, Hartron, none of the Trons succeeded. Central Electronics did not succeed. Rajasthan Electronics did not succeed. And we had to ultimately open up the economy to global companies to set up electronics manufacturing facility. So on electronics, I would say Ashok's contribution, profound in consumer, in professional, and defense electronics, but highly questionable in the area of consumer electronics. Finally, I would say there's one area in which Ashok was really, truly a pioneer. We don't see him here. I think he passed away. Tapan Bhattacharya? Tapan passed away. But Tapan Bhattacharya and Ashok really deserve full credit for making India take first steps in the field of solar energy. In fact, most people today who are enamored of solar don't realize that India was a world leader in solar energy in 1983. And I remember sitting with Ashok in Bhartinagar discussing NASPED. There was a project that Indira Gandhi had started called NASPED. It was called the National Solar Photovoltaic Demonstration Program. It was not a big facility. It was a megawatt scale facility. But the first steps that India took in creating solar cell making, silicon making capacity, and device making capacity. Today, of course, we are one of the biggest countries as far as solar energy is concerned. But 30 years ago, long before the Americans, the Germans, the Chinese had discovered the values and virtues of solar energy, India was at the cutting edge. I think we faltered because of Ashok's obsession with the public sector, Ashok's reluctance, in fact, complete hostility to opening up the solar industry to private players, and our dependence only on Central Electronics, I think, cost us that leadership. But I want to acknowledge the fact that in the 80s, when the world was talking of oil, India was talking of new and renewable sources. In fact, Mrs. Gandhi was only one of four heads of state who spoke at the first UN conference on new and renewable energy at Nairobi in 1980, after she had come back to power. And Ashok had much to do with the preparation of that speech and preparation for that conference. So on solar energy, I think Ashok deserves full marks. And extraordinarily, he got into a very strange controversy. Here was Ashok, the great champion of self-reliance, the great champion of Indian technology, suddenly being accused of getting foreign technology for silicon. If you remember, the National Silicon Facility, the fight between CSIR on the one side, the fight between CSIR on one side and Ashok on the other. And I found it ironical that the champion of self-reliance was being accused in the media and by CSIR of all people of sabotaging Indian self-reliance. But I think there again, postures got taken, and again, India missed the bus in becoming a world leader in silicon. But it was not for want of any effort on the part of Ashok. And that chapter, in fact, has been dealt with extensively in this book. So all in all, I am delighted to be here. I agree with Ashok, I agree with Siddharth that he had many more years of educating to do, because he was a repository of all that had gone on in Indian science and Indian technology over a four-decade period. We could argue with him, we could have strong positions with him. He would often disagree with me on the positions that I had taken, but he always maintained an open door as far as I was concerned. And very recently, I spent lots of time with him discussing his period with Haksa for the book on Haksa that I wrote, in which Ashok plays a very important role. Siddharth mentioned another Ashok. In fact, both the Ashoks joined the government at roughly the same time. One was Ashok, and that was the time, by the way, when prime ministers were encouraging people to join the Prime Minister's Secretariat. So you had a 30-year-old Ashok Parsarthi and you had a 29-year-old Ashok Khosla, positions, Ashok Khosla, taking positions relating to policy, not just dealing with matters of administration, but actually dealing with matters of high policy. I hope that somebody will actually write about Ashok, write about the wonderful, distinguished family that he belongs to, and all the contributions that he made and the controversies he generated, because we would be unfair to Ashok if we were to airbrush all the controversies and all the other points of view which have equal validity as the point of view that he made major contributions to building India's science capability. Thank you.
Dr. Ramesh has made a reference to Ashok's lineage. This is not what we are here to discuss this evening. It reminds me that this site, this plot, stood a very fine gray stone building, which had been replaced by this complex some years ago. That is the original IAC complex designed by Stein. And on the ground floor, we had a certain organization functioning here for many years called RIS. And on the first floor, facing towards the Lodhi estate, was a nice circular room, glazed with a very nice view, where Mr. G.P. Saab sat, chairman of the RIS. When I joined this organization, I had the privilege of getting to know him, And when he got to know a little bit about my past background, you mentioned just now to 370 and all that, I had enormously beneficial discussion with him upstairs, which were not part of any record. Coming to Ashok, all of you good friends have said good things about him. I think in one simple word, Ashok was an activist. Activist for advancement of science and technology. Very simple terminology. I got to know him around 70, end of 72, 73, very, very young man. I don't know, Dr. Ramesh, whether you remember that Punjab was the first state government which took the initiative of seeking to establish a factory to manufacture the first indigenously designed tractor.
Swaraj tractor.
Now, we ran into enormous problem, which today you will attribute to bureaucracy, to which I belong. But the net result was that our chief executive was a very outstanding engineer by the name of Mr. Chandramohan. He was at a wit's end because our economics wouldn't work out. The cost at which we could produce Swaraj was 3.5 times more than the CKD units. And the brief answer was to persuade use of Mr. C. Subramaniam's influence to get to the PMO and get the, you know, advantages enjoyed by the CKD importers to be knocked off. After a lot of ferreting around, one learned that the gentleman who could possibly help is a young man called Ashok Parthasarathy. So we established contact with him, and I invited him formally to, I was director of industries, to Chandigarh. And he spent a lot of time in getting to know the project. After that, for the next 2 years, not less than 2 years, 2.5 years, he was batting for us to get the embargo lifted. That was my first acquaintance. I've known Ashok, though not meeting him frequently enough, for the last, you can say, 35, 40 years. And then professionally, I had occasion to work alongside him when you were in finance and he was in renewable energy. You remember the Mr. Gujral's time. And he ran into cultural problem with his minister who belonged to a certain part of the country and not known very much for scientific growth or scientific development. The minister was disdainful that Dr. Parthasarathy goes abroad and doesn't come back. So I said, what exactly does it mean? I asked him on behalf of the Prime Minister. He said, 5 din ke liye gaya tha, 12 din ho gaye. So I waited for Ashok to come. So I visited his office and found that he was actually away for about 13, 14 days. When the sanction was for 5 days. That led to some other consequences. But Ashok was that time working quite assiduously in the arena of non-conventional renewable sources. And of course, when I came to work in this institution, I saw a great deal of him, Pugwash, various other meetings we used to have here. So I would like briefly to, without knowing all the scientific things which you're talking about, to associate myself with all the good things you said about him. He was an innovator, he was persuasive, he was an activist, and I think among other things, whatever else one may say, not say about Ashok, he was a highly motivated person in the realm of advancement of science and technology. And he had his beliefs, you may have agreed or disagreed with him. He did enormous work, as all our good friends have said this evening. So I'd like to close this evening's program. I won't go into anecdotes. Dr. Ravi is sitting here, and we semiconductors in Chandigarh. There are many stories about Ashok, but this is not the time. To thank everybody, all his good friends, admirers, who assembled here this evening. and joined us in this small event to remember Ashok. I particularly recognize Mrs. Parthasarathy and Mrs. Baldev Singh, whom I have known from a very young age. Thank you very much.